Sorry for the technical problems. I would like to welcome you to the Robotics Colloquium and also to the new academic year. As you could see, I don't know if Ray can show, we will try to rotate you 13, 15 people per time. So I would like to spend the day today describing the expectations about the program in this particular class, give you a little bit of introduction to the Robotics Institute, to the program, and also I'm going to show you a few things regarding the research that is happening. Okay, so before we start, any questions? So let me give you a brief introduction to Minery, okay, how we are created, and then I will tell you a little bit about the class, and then we're going to go into some research. And next week we're going to have Histosonics, is a local startup that is doing robotics and sensing for treatment of cancer. The week after we're going to have MSROver Robotics, so is another local startup that is building devices. And you are going to see hopefully a healthy balance between academicians, industry. In fact, you are going to hear a very interesting talk about how is to create a robotics company, how to raise money, how to do all the things which are necessary in order to be successful, or basically what may happen. So I'm the director. I'm also a professor in computer science. I'm at the university 30 years. So I think we're going to go this way because something is. So what is the new reality? If you look at the Amazon Robotics, which used to be Kiva, was purchased by Amazon for 11 times sales. And just to give you two other things which happened, John Deere bought two startups in robotics for agriculture, Blue River, I believe, for $300 million, and another one very, very recently, the name escapes me, for $250 million. So if you look, medicine, agriculture, manufacturing, supply chain is everywhere. If you look at surgical robotics, Da Vinci, the majority or all the urological surgeries that have to do with cancer are done with Da Vinci. There are more than 20 of them in Mayo. Medtronic is in this game with the Hugo robots, the Google or Waymo car, and the stories of the autopilot and the beloved Tesla. I mean, I was reading in the last few months, there are 12 incidents that involve Teslas and emergency vehicles. Somehow the cameras, because Tesla is exclusively using cameras and radar for some of the, they have problems with the flashing lights. And there are some interesting lessons that we can learn. If you look for the 2017, the robotics market was around $40 billion, and the 2025 projection is half a trillion. If you look at iRobot, basically the vacuum cleaners, they were losing money big time for a long time. And there was the Allen of Microsoft behind them, and they created a market from nothing, basically. Right now, their market capitalization is over 2 billion. I believe it's 2.4, 2.8. If you look at Minnesota, we have the most first robotics teams per capita than any other state in the nation. So some of you have seen this, but always I like to show this video clip with Da Vinci. Think about you have prostate cancer, or you have a prostate surgery. Basically, in the past, you had to stay 1 week at least, and there was a lot of blood. Now with robotics and Da Vinci, basically you can live the same day. I just had a friend who was able to go back to work within a few days. So think about the things that you can do, especially if one considers all these new tools, virtual environments that you can use in order to train the robot in order to accomplish a task. Now, when you look at this, this is a system that needs, and I mentioned in the robotics class that we need to manage expectations, okay? You need to have someone at least with a master in order to maintain a device like this. A device like this costs more than $1 million, and the maintenance is also quite expensive. Now, if you look at Hugo, which is another competitor by Medtronic, Medtronic invested at least $500 million on this whole system. But they found the hard way that is not, when you have robotics in medicine, you need to have approvals. You need to have other things which may not be as trivial. And in fact, Hugo is questionable how successful it was. Just to tell you something about Da Vinci. Da Vinci almost failed in the US multiple times. What really saved Da Vinci? Basically, the European market, because they were able to get approval before basically they got approval in the US. In fact, if you look at the history of the stock of Intuitive Surgical, every time there is a lawsuit, because the machine may not be responsible for any, but people may sue Intuitive because they have a lot of money. The stock loses 20-30%. And this is something that we need to consider. It's not only that we need to build good systems, we need to understand the implications, or we need to make sure that these devices are safe and proven to be safe. Now, all you know, and in fact, just to give you an idea, look at the robots from Kiva that are used in the Amazon warehouse. Now, what you see here is very, is the ideal scenario. If you go in an Amazon warehouse, you are going to see a lot of people not only crashing with each other, but also crashing with the robots. So the interface between humans and robots is really one that we need to consider. But I have been to the one in Sakopi. There are 2,000 trucks getting in every day. Think about this. And it's mind-boggling when you see this stuff, and especially with COVID, I want to remind you, without the supply chain, we would have been doomed. And in fact, the companies that did very well, like Target, Best Buy, part of the success was the supply chain. So they are investing heavily. In fact, I saw Best Buy looking for a machine learning / robotics senior VP, which is very interesting. In fact, we help Best Buy create a store. You can look at Best Buy New York, and you can see a store that has robots picking CDs and other stuff and movies and delivering to the customer. Very impressive. But financially, the company decided they don't want to invest further. What are the gaps when you see this stuff? We have a lot of computer scientists, electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, but we don't have a lot of roboticists. So we don't have this blending of robotics with other sciences and engineering. There is always the concern about loss of data, loss of jobs, and data privacy, and loss of data. I just got another warning today that my account, among millions of others, are compromised. Think of a UAV, okay, that instead of doing agricultural stuff, its security is compromised and is used for other purposes. And you understand what I mean. So in fact, I heard several of you, you were asked, when you had an interview at the embassy, you were asked that, or you were reminded, robotics is a very sensitive area. I will leave it there. We need to redesign. I mean, the way I was taught robotics is not applicable to robotics that we have today. So there are a lot of issues in planning, control, sensing, actuation, and we need to create benchmarks. We don't know when these systems work, when they fail, and so on and so forth. Finally, you are the biggest resource right now. And in fact, people are struggling. I will give you one idea. I have six companies that they want a tiny office in this space, not because they like me, they like you, they want you. They want to have access to you. Now, it sounds crazy, but if you look at the history of robotics, people believe, okay, I have supply chain problems. I'm going to throw robots. I'm going to pay a lot of money and I'm going to hire people and then magically everything is going to work. But this is not the case, unfortunately. So MINRI, it was created in 2019, but there were several years of history behind it. In fact, we were started, did I show you the video clip of the Scout in the robotics class or no? If we have time, I will show you. So several of my students and me started a company called Recon Robotics in 2005. Eventually, this company built 6,000. We are not involved anymore, nor were multimillionaires. We were kicked out in the first few months because we are not really business people. We didn't understand what it means preferred stock versus normal stock. But what did it happen? 6,000 robots were built. At one point, there were 120 people in manufacturing jobs. And the company is still in existence, so the state decided to invest in robotics as one of the key technologies. So we will be getting millions of dollars, not us, but basically the university, and they need to have something in robotics. And this started the MIN drive. Then a donor gave us Jim Wynell. Gave us $10 million, and we hope more donors or the same donor is going to put more money. Why? Because he believes in the education, and he believes that if we can teach you on how to be creative, innovative in this area, that we can create so much change. Okay? He believes in the power of education. So what you see here is, basically, is donation plus a few million from the state. And also we have, if you look at the CS rankings, this is ranked number 5 in robotics in the whole US. Now, all these rankings, you know, are really questionable, but the thing that counts, despite the fact that they count 8 faculty in robotics, if you look the production of papers, funding, and so on and so forth, is higher than Georgia Tech, for example, which is one of the biggest programs. Now, we are very proud of this facility, but I will take you at one of the future lectures at the Hasselmann facility, and you need to see some of the tools that we have there, from a Vicon system to basically all sorts of manufacturing, where we're making some of the robots that are part of the program. Again, you know, we have these key areas. Agriculture and medicine are the key. And I will say here, I will stop here, you know, this website. I will say what is expected from this class, okay? Have you all seen the canvas for this class? So basically, we want you to write. So there are two TAs, but basically you have to deal with me. We want you to attend. Everything will be available online, but we want you to attend at least everything, but you can miss only one or two reports. The report could be a PDF file, one page that answers basically a few prompts. What you like, what you didn't like, what you learned out of this, what this was interesting. I mean, have you seen the questions that they were asking? It shouldn't take more than half an hour, okay? But my suggestion will be over the weekend after each lecture, the lectures will be available almost instantaneously, just fill this report. Last year, we had a far smaller class. Basically, I would say only one or two people had trouble, but everybody passed the class. It's pass or fail. So key is absorb and understand what is going on. Meet some of the key players, because this may be your future employers or your advisors in your capstone. So this is, that's why we insist that everyone should take this course, because we want you to see this as your meeting point, especially with COVID. We want to see you. We want you also to see us. I mean, the biggest problem last year is actually everything was virtual, so we didn't have any communication. Okay? Any questions about this? Okay, let's proceed. I want to show you a few of the things, and then my colleagues. So I want you to see a little bit. So there is a company in town, and in fact, I tried to convince them to come and give you a talk called Centera. Google them. In fact, they have moved to some new offices. This was a company that started from engineers, from Lockheed. They were let to go when the whole defense died. But they had a few patents in UAVs, and they had a lot of experience in military UAVs. So are becoming very successful in using UAVs for agriculture. In other words, there is something called precision agriculture. In fact, six of my students are basically the whole machine learning AI group. And they told me they are looking for more. My students, I mean, not only in a very narrow term, but in wider term. So let's see. If you look at Minnesota, what is happening? In October, for corn, we apply nitrogen, $750 million worth of nitrogen. What is happening? This is washed away, okay, in the winter. Where does it go? To the Mississippi. Where does the Mississippi go? To the Gulf of Mexico. If you see the delta of Mississippi, it's basically so much algae from all this nitrogen that it's basically there are no living species there. So think of the following. Think that you have a ground robot, like the robot, and a UAV that you fly over, and basically you can say this area needs fertilizer and this area doesn't need fertilizer. So instead of blindly applying fertilizer, let's do this strategically. Just for Minnesota, the savings are almost $100 million from the reduction in fertilizer usage, and the yield improvement may be almost $835 million. Why is it interesting from a robotics perspective? Because you can collect a lot of data. The take-home message from all the stuff we're going to discuss today is the following, is that robotics is very cool, but robotics plus data is extremely cool and powerful. It's all about data these days. So if we forget, the robots are basically flying out there and give us information. If we can have RGB plus hyperspectral, we know a lot about the plant health. And in fact, we can use all these different sensory modalities in order to create planned reconstructions, 3D reconstructions. In other words, when we have a plant, and I don't know if I have shown you, to some of you, I believe I saw these cone plants that we have, the artificials on the second floor. Why do we do this? Because we try to do these reconstructions very accurately. For example, we look at the number of stems, at the angles that we have, how long are the stems? Because basically this tells us something about the health of the plant. And robotics is a very powerful tool in order to collect this information. Think about what we do as humans, okay? We try to build a map of this space. We move around. And if we move, if we can make ourselves to move around in a purposeful way, in other words, I'm not going to go in the same direction continuously because I don't have new extra information. But if I start moving in a way that maximizes the amount of information that I receive, then I have what we call a closed loop system that is going to maximize the sensory intake that we have. In other words, we have very powerful data. So the idea is, how do I move in order to maximize the data and the quality of the data that I have? Now, you can see here, we have these 3D reconstructions. And look, there are different stages of corn, and you can see basically how these are rebuilt. And if we can annotate this with extra information about, okay, this area looks that needs nitrogen, then we'll have a very powerful proposition there. I will tell you another application. Let me show you this video clip. The person who created this video clip is Ruben Dessa. Ruben is a very senior scientist at OpenAI and is doing the robotics work. So he spent several years with us building this transformer robot, basically from a quadro rotor transform itself to a fixed wing. Why? Because if I have to move in a field, fixed wing is very, I mean, you cannot get much data. How are you going to turn in order to go and fly around the plant? So this, especially with soybean, this created the need to design this robot. If you look at this system, the controls, in fact, we were writing yesterday a paper at 2 o'clock, the controls of this are highly nonlinear. And what you try to get out, the motors that you need in order to just glide are completely different than the motors that you need in order to create lift. So how you can use the same motors for these two different tasks is extremely challenging. Okay, questions? Yeah. You mean the power that you need? Yeah, so this thing will fly around 10 minutes. And one of the things is that we are developing this system, although we are developing this for a long, long time, that uses solar power. In fact, the person who started this project is at SpaceX, responsible for this. And Ruben, we started as, let's study the power, the solar power as a way of moving these UAVs. If you ask me how far we have moved on this part, I will tell you very little. We can build these very complex mechanisms. And in fact, the majority of the fabrication is done in Haselmo. Just, I want you to get and feel that you are citizens of a community, but there are a lot of resources you can use in order to do a lot of this very cool stuff, okay? You can build everything. In fact, as I mentioned, in the robotics class, we have two manipulators basically in a box, Kinova, very interesting manipulators, and several turtlebot burgers, I believe more than 10, in the loading dock. So I'm not going to use them. You can use them. Do projects. Create small thesis, I mean, capstone projects. I mean, start thinking about possibilities here. Now, there is another important aspect, which is phenotypes. In other words, we try to phenotype the plant, understand the geometry, the dimensions, all the other things that we can use in order to say, I think try to do this with peppers. Everything is green. Okay, how are you going to extract this information? But you can use stereo cameras or LiDAR in order to get some of these structures. And think, for example, about combining this with soil testing for some of these applications. And some of the data with respect to the plant, and so on and so forth. So I'm going to go and cover the work of a few other faculty, for example, the deep behavioral imaging of Professor Hyun-Soo Park, who, by the way, is in charge also of a Toyota Institute site as part of the Toyota Initiative on Autonomous Cars. So Hyun-Soo, we're very fortunate to have him on board, basically is using hundreds of cameras for reconstruction. And you can see here some of his work. And who you think is the person on the right here, in this area? This is 2019, just before the... Is the president of the university, Dr. Gable. Okay, so she was a subject in the reconstruction. And this was at the state fair, the old good days. Now, think about the following. You can use this information in order to track monkeys without having to torture the animals with markers and so on and so forth. So the monkeys can move freely, and then we can extract a lot of behavioral data by using this setup of cameras. Now, the stories of students, and I think that it's important. Ruben, he was with us since undergrad, since freshman. He received his PhD. Now he's so senior, he doesn't even reply to my calls. I'm still waiting for him to finish two journal papers from his thesis. He has not published a single journal paper because he's so busy, and we are insignificant anymore, okay? In fact, I look at his contract, and this is probably more than the president of the university, just to give you an idea. And I recall when he joined us, he was basically so green that he asked me a question about what is a UAV, okay? So we are very proud of him, and we are very proud of you all, because we are really thrilled to see this trajectory of growth. Geneva is a mean drive scholar. We used to do a lot of outreach. Hopefully we can start again. And I would like so we can learn a lot by observing nature. So this comes from Case Western Reserve. I don't think it's part of the lectures in the robotics class. Look at the WEGs. These are very inexpensive devices that were built by Professor Roger Keane at Case Western Reserve. We are observing cockroaches and how they move. So we can build some very interesting systems just by looking at this, at nature, at the way that animals and living things move around. And this is the inspiration. So this is another one. Let me show you this one. So you know about deep learning. What do you know about cancer? I mean, it's a topic that is, I can tell you, one of the toughest things is basically waiting after a biopsy. And you may be waiting, so they take a sample that for prostate looks like this, on the right, and basically the slices go to a pathologist slash oncologist. They put some stains and then they say, for example, what type of cancer it is or if it is benign, and also if it has moved to the lymph nodes, if it is metastatic. And the worst is actually during surgery, for example, in breast cancer, they decide about the margins by looking at images like this. So think about making decisions that may impact your well-being by trying to say, is this purple enough? So several of the students at MINRI are looking at this problem from more perspectives and for different types of cancer. Because basically we try to say, for prostate, the benign looks like this, the malignancy looks like that. So instead of waiting for 10 days, you can annotate automatically the data, so the pathologist, oncologist can have all this information based on computer vision and machine learning in order to do the differentiation. Okay? So think about the power of these tools. Okay, it's very unique. Now, can we substitute? I gave a talk to the dermatology group in the Twin Cities, and they told me, should we be scared about jobs? I said, no, because I will never trust, always want the clinician to be in charge, but we want to make sure that the clinician has the full information in order to make an assessment. Because we're talking about life or death here. Now, I want to show you a little bit how we can use convolutional networks in order basically to do this type of classification. And in fact, one of the problems is actually what we call active learning. Instead of the system just you feed it with data, the system asks you, give me data of this type, because this is what I need in order to be trained better. And it's called active learning. And in fact, my student who is now at Waymo had one of the most cited papers in this area about active learning. So we want you to be exposed not only to the robots, they are very cool, but also to all these algorithms that can empower these systems. There is another one. For example, can we, and this is the work that we are doing in kidney cancer in conjunction with Chris Waite, can we have, if you have a kidney and you have a tumor versus an angiomyolipoma, which is something benign, but it's very bloody. In other words, it's not an easy surgery and you need to monitor. So if we can develop these computer vision and machine learning tools, we can have continuous monitoring of these tumors and not intervene unless it's absolutely necessary. So in other words, we can save in a lot of the surgeries that need to be done. So there is a shift of protocols from what I mentioned to basically we gather a lot of information and we make decisions, but informed decisions, not by eyeballing what is happening. We have done work, for example, trying to classify skin cancer versus other type of, and this area is expanding a lot. And in fact, it's not so much in melanoma, but in kidney cancer. If you look, we have a challenge. So we have data from 300 people and teams around the world are competing with the others in order basically to have the most improved results. Now, again, are we trying to substitute the clinician? No. There is another area that is very close to my heart and is using computer vision. I don't have time to go. I want to leave a little bit of time for questions, but using cameras and other sensors and virtual environments in order to assess and provide biofeedback for mental health disorders. For example, are you aware of the Tourette syndrome? These are vocal and motor tics, which is or are often associated with anxiety and obsessive compulsive disorders. Just the impact of Tourette to the US economy is supposed to exceed $3 to $4 billion, because Tourette doesn't come alone. Creates agoraphobia, so the fear of being in public, creates depression, and so on and so forth. So we try to develop tools, let's say on an iPad, that a family practitioner can use in order to monitor, let's say, a kid and have early diagnosis. The same for autism, the same for schizophrenia, and for other things. And now we are at the second step, and we have this very cool facility at Hasselmo, where we provide feedback. In other words, the system monitors the tics, and then the subject uses the cognitive tools in order to manage their tics, and then the system says, continue what you are doing. Or, why don't you focus on your motor tics, for example? And it's very exciting because you can avoid. So early detection is very key in neuropsychiatric disorders. And the second thing, you can provide treatment with cognitive therapy that doesn't involve drugs. So for example, if you look at obsessive compulsive disorders, if you try to intervene at the age of 25, it's too late. But if you teach a kid cognitive tools, you can be far more effective. And also there is the area of telepsychiatry, which has been booming, especially with COVID. In fact, we are developing a system that can monitor the overall behavior of a subject and then say to the clinician, why don't you watch this spot on the video and this spot on the video for unusual behaviors? Any questions? There is Professor Gini also, which works by using robots for robots are very well accepted by kids. So it seems that there is a far friendlier interaction between robots and children in the autistic spectrum. The last thing I want to cover and shows you that Minery is not about buildings and spaces, it's about people. I want to show you a system that was developed by Ted Morris, who is a research scientist at Minery, and basically monitors truck stops. And you are going to tell me, why do you monitor truck stops? Give me a minute, because I want you. So what's this? So do you see the red stuff? It shows you if a place, if the place is occupied or not. Look at night. And I want you to see snow. Do you think snow is easier or tougher? It's easier. Unless you are basically, you want to, you care about the lane markers. But you see how different the background is with snow. So, why do you think we use a system like this, 24 hours, 7 days a week, for the last 6 years? 22 sites in Kansas, one in Wisconsin, and we're moving into Ohio. Why do you think we care about this? What? Parking fee, let's think well-being, human well-being. What do you want, why do you want the truck drivers to rest at safe locations? Yeah, so there is a federal mandate that says you need to drive X hours and then you need to rest. In the winter especially, there is so much overcrowding that they park anywhere. So think of a FedEx truck just getting out of the way and killing X people. It has happened in Rochester. Think about the impact, and trucks are basically, with trains, are the major backbones of the supply chain system. So think about the possibility of, as you drive, and in fact, coming from North Dakota, from Fargo, you can see, it says, for example, this site has three openings, no openings. And you guide the drivers to go to a location that has enough safe spots to park. So think about applying this to a parking ramp facility, not only at a mall, but actually at the hospital, at the airport. So instead of having cars driving, you can basically guide the cars in order to park safely in a location that has enough. Now, the thing which is amazing about this system is that this works all this time, even when we had extreme weather conditions. Think about blinding snow, the system still had more than 80% accuracy. And it has reached the point where we can say we have a spot for a small track, not for a big double size trailer, basically. Okay? So all this expertise, and much more that you are going to hear as we go into the semester, is part of this unique set of people that span five different colleges. They have very different backgrounds. And in fact, they are very eager to have you, but not at this moment. After a few months where you basically you have a little bit of the background and you understand your interests, as part of their teams, doing your capstone projects, and so on and so forth. So I want to conclude by saying we're very excited to have you all, especially under these circumstances. It was extremely lonely to be basically behind the Zoom screen. We're here to help. Feel free to contact us. There are two people who are assisting me in this class is Dario Canelon and Mike Fulton. And Ray, of course, will do all the serious stuff with the videotaping and putting it on Zoom. But use this as an opportunity to learn what is happening, who are the players, and also to network. I think it's extremely important, especially in the days that we live, that you network. Okay, I'm going to stop here. Any questions you may have? Yeah. As, tell me your name also. So basically, we have a little bit more.
I'm Mayan. My question is, so you had mentioned earlier that robotics is a mixture of multiple fields, like mechanical, electrical, computer science. Now, there are students who are studying this one particular field for their master's for 2 years and so on. How do we as roboticists cover all these fields in the same amount of time?
Yeah, that's a great question. I will tell you what might be one path that you can follow. Get outside your comfort zone, especially not the first semester. The first semester you want, and I'm saying this publicly through Zoom, I want you to be conservative. In other words, take courses, a reasonable number of courses, like 2 or 3, plus the colloquium. Don't take 5 or 6. I had a case last year. Basically, I told him, I'm not going to speak to you or advise you unless you drop the number of courses. Of course, he proved me wrong. He graduated in 2 semesters. But he almost had a nervous breakdown. Okay, I don't think it's worth it. So start conservatively, and then spring semester, take something which is outside your comfort zone. Take a class in psychology. You know, the program is very flexible. We count as long as it's not skiing, basketball, and any other curling, and any other physical activity, as long. For example, I will take an optimization class. Things that they are going to expand your horizons. In fact, I will give you a story of a kid who is working for MnDOT, okay? He's an international kid, and he was telling me, Nikos, is MnDOT going to hire me? But the connection happened. MnDOT came and gave a presentation of a project. They are building a robot for measuring the thickness of pavement automatically. So there was nobody else. So he was hired, and they love him. So if you would have asked me that as Minri would have sent a student doing a capstone project and being paid as a consultant to MnDOT, I would have told you this is never going to happen. Because it's a very conservative state agency. But it was the interest, I will say, the fact that this student was eager to go out of his comfort zone why will he do pavement? But this is a real need, because we are sending people, as cars drive 60, 70 miles an hour, to take cores of pavement in order to measure the thickness of pavement. This is not a job that anyone wants to do. But a robot, worst case scenario, is actually, and if you look, I hope to have this team give you a presentation. If you look at the system, it's very cool. So again, we try to increase the distance between humans and harm's way. But also you need to be willing to get outside of your comfort zone. If you were asking me, for example, that I would have been doing after 30 years in robotics, work in trying to understand cancer or mental health disorders, I will have told you that this was not part of my plan. It just happened that these people came to us with very cool problems that needed very different solutions. I don't have time, but I will show you when we get the opportunity, the Scout. In fact, if you go to we have a lot of videos. You don't see anything? So let me go and write this. Okay, thank you. So, take home message. The future of robotics is all this cool hardware plus sensing plus data. And even if we take the robotics out, sensing and data is the future. I mean, this is where there are big, big investments. But if you want to see a lot of cool videos, you can go z.umn.edu, where we have all sorts of robots, things that fly, swim, and if we have time, I can show you some upstairs after we are done. But basically, it's a lot. It's all about the creativity of the people. The person who built the Scout, one of the key people, almost was not admitted into the mechanical engineering program here, because he couldn't care about ACT and the other stuff. The person who was also a key designer was an architect. And he had this different approach to design, which is completely different than the approach of a mechanical engineer. So we need all these changes in perspective in order to have these powerful systems. And expose yourself to things. Don't take a class you had taken before, especially in spring semester and after. Just get out and take courses that are going to be exciting for you and that are going to open your horizons. I know it's tempting. For example, I was thinking when I was a student several decades back, oh, I have had two courses in robotics in Greece. I will keep taking robotics courses. But I was able to finish my PhD thesis in 3 years because I took a course in adaptive control. And there was one sentence that clicked with me that the instructor said. I didn't take anything else out of this class. But when I heard this sentence, which is actually adaptive control is for systems where we don't know much about the parameters, it basically helped me. I had the formulation of the whole thesis in a week. So it was just this moment. And this is how I created a thesis. This is how I came here as a faculty member. So it's just for the better or the worse, there are these little moments in our lives that can be detrimental. Any other questions? Thank you. Stay well. If you are interested, we can go upstairs. The only thing I will ask you is actually if I can break you into groups of six, and I can show you some of the robots upstairs. Okay. Ray, are we done? Thank you.